In the third video segment, I want to draw a distinction between what we call nominal and real GDP. If we were to go out there and look, we would see that from year to year, most of the time, total spending on Y equals C plus G plus I plus net exports, rises from year to year for two separate reasons. One of them is that most years, when the economy is not in a recession, the economy is actually producing more stuff than it was the year before. Most years, the labor force is a little bit bigger than it was the previous year. Most years, technology has improved some, and firms have more capital and equipment and so on than they had the previous years. So most years, total production rises. But at the same time, most years, we experience some level of inflation, some level of rising prices. And obviously, those are two very different things. The first is pretty much a good thing. You know, the economy is becoming more productive, and that's good. The second is not so clear that it's such a good thing. Higher prices might be nice for the sellers, but the buyers might not feel that way. So nominal production, nominal GDP, is when we just measure the dollar volume of all the transactions that go into GDP. But what we're really interested in is real GDP. And real GDP attempts to correct for inflation, attempts to track the real production of goods and services, and strip out the way in which inflation makes things grow over time, even when real production hasn't. And so what we're going to do to measure real GDP is that we're going to value goods and services by the amount that they cost in what we call the base year. So that's our standard of comparison. And in the base year itself, nominal GDP and real GDP are the same. In later years, things are going to be different. And let me go ahead and build an example here. So let's go ahead and look at a little simple economy that is going to have two different goods here. We're going to have aspirin and doctor's visits. And aspirin prices are going up over time from 2009 to 2010, 2011. And the actual quantity of aspirin is growing as well. So total spending on aspirin is going up for both of those reasons. Likewise, doctor's visits are going up in price over time, but also the actual quantity of doctor visits, real production is going up over time, total spending is rising for a mixture of those two. So for nominal GDP in each year, we just add together the total spending on the different goods, and we get nominal GDP that way. Then to get real GDP, what we do is we value the production in each year by the price in the base year. And I'm going to use 2009 as my base year. So what I've done here is I've gone ahead and said, we're going to go ahead and set the price here equal to what it was in 2009. So I'm telling Excel, go look in cell C15 for how to value aspirin in each of those years. So even though the price of aspirin changed, we're going to ignore that. We're going to continue to value aspirin at what it was worth in 2009. So looked at this way, the actual value of the aspirin increased from 100 to 150 to 200, exactly mirroring the actual increase in production. Likewise, when we look at the doctor's visits, we use the original price from 2009 and multiply that by the quantity in each case. So the actual production goes and doubles and then gets up to triple to what it originally was. Likewise, the way we value all those visits doubles and then reaches triple of what it once was. And so our real GDP, using 2009 as a base year, is when we use the price from 2009 to value the goods in the later years. We could have run it backwards using 2011 as the base year, but that's not usually how it's done. So in this case, you can see that we get a significantly lower estimate. So using nominal GDP gives an inflated picture of how much production has grown because we've allowed the inflation to influence our calculation. Here, we've stripped out the influence of inflation, and we see that instead of thinking that economic activity grew by a factor of 6, it grew by a factor of 2.5. Another thing that's often done here is we calculate what's called the GDP deflator. And the GDP deflator is the ratio between nominal GDP in a given year and real GDP in a given year. So it gives us an estimate of how inflated things have gotten. So look here, what we do is we're going to take the blue one here, the nominal GDP in that year, over the red one here, the real GDP in that given year, and multiply by 100. And then that tells us, essentially, how much prices have increased. So we can use this to calculate inflation. And what we do to calculate inflation is we calculate the percentage change between these 2 years. So you can see here to get from 100 to 171 that we've risen by 71%. A little bit less obviously, as we go from 171 to 240, and the 240 again comes about from the ratio of nominal GDP over real GDP for that year. As we go from 171 to 240, we've had a 40% rise. So prices rose in this little toy economy. Prices rose 71% between 2009 and 2010, and prices rose 40% between 2010 and 2011. So we talked about the GDP deflator, and the GDP deflator, to get technical, is one type of what we call a price index that allows us to measure the average price in the economy. And chapter 11 of the Mankiw textbook gets into price indexes in more detail, and I'll talk about other economic indexes at that time. Just to reemphasize it here, how do we calculate the inflation rate? We calculate the inflation rate as the percentage change in a price index. The GDP deflator is one type of price index, so we can use the GDP deflator to measure the inflation rate as the rate of change in the GDP inflator. So we take the new value, subtract off the old value, divide by the old value, and then multiply that whole thing by 100. Here's a review question for you guys to go ahead and look at. And that is the end of this video segment.